Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sachin Jain, and I was a part of the first cohort of Teach for India from 2009 to 2011. I taught in a municipal school in Mumbai called Supari Tank Municipal School. I taught grade 3 and then I moved with my pupils to grade 4. So today I just want to talk a little bit about my journey as someone who was working in the corporate sector, who did not belong in the social sector, who and what it was for me to learn firsthand leadership and learning in the underprivileged primary school environment in Mumbai. So when I started with Teach for India and I received my acceptance, I went for training at Summer Institute, and we had about 6 weeks of training there, and then we were placed in our placement school. So when I actually went to my school in Mumbai, I received a big shock, because what I found was that the classroom on average was 3.5 grade levels behind where it was supposed to be. So this was a third grade classroom, but most of the pupils were testing at KG or pre-KG levels. I just wanted to introduce you to some of my students. So this was Fatima. When I joined my class and I met Fatima, Fatima could not write down A to Z. Nobody in her family spoke in English, and the 4 hours that she spent in the classroom in school was the only time that she actually got to speak in English. This is Pratap. Pratap is an amazing breakdancer, and what happened was that when I entered school, I realized that the only thing that he had experienced so far was a teacher telling him, okay, copy down from here to here 6 times. So what he was doing was just calligraphy without actually understanding what the letters mean as words and what the words mean as sentences. This is Prince. Now Prince is a very keen student, but he couldn't go beyond saying C-A-T, cat. And in third grade, he was already slipping really behind the other pupils from more privileged schools who were getting much more ahead. And this is Trupti. So Trupti would spend her entire day in the school just staring blankly ahead, and she would occasionally slip down under her desk and she would cry. So this is a microcosm of a larger problem in our country. So most of us have been privileged to not only go to school but also go to college and to get an undergraduate education. And we are actually only 6% of our country. So if this hall was actually India, only maybe this part of the hall would be the people who would have the privilege to go to NIT Surathkal. And what is the reason that we have such a state of education in our country? It's what we call the achievement gap. So for example, if the blue line is a student in a high income school, what happens is when the red line is a student in a low income school, when both these students are at kindergarten level, their knowledge and skills are the same. But as they successively progress, as you can see, the higher income school student, when he or she is in grade 8, their skill level is at grade 8. But for the student from a low income school, they are slipping down. So by the time the low income school student actually reaches grade 10, their knowledge and skill levels are of 5th grade level. So they are not really employable. And this is what we call as the achievement gap. Now the result of this achievement gap is that with every successive grade, the student is falling further and further behind. It's like stretching a rubber band. And at some point that rubber band snaps and the pupil drops out of the school system. It's for the boys, it's either for economic reasons, and for the girls, it's very often for social reasons. So that's where we believe we come in, into the primary school education system. And what we believe in is taking that red line and making it meet the blue line, so that at the end of their schooling, a child from an underprivileged school has the same opportunities for a lifetime as a child from a privileged school. So then when my co-teacher Elena and I entered our school, we decided that the first thing we want to do was to set a vision or a goal for our students. So we asked our students, what do you want to be? They came up with many answers. Some said, you know, they want to be a footballer. Some said they want to be a dance director. So Sohail wanted to be a footballer. Aves wants to be a rock star. Najma wants to be a dance director, but nobody said teacher. Nobody wanted to be a teacher. So what we did is, we first decided that we will set a goal for each student in every area of learning. So for example, for reading fluency, if a child is reading 8 words correct per minute, our goal for that child is that at the end of this 1 year, the child should be testing at 60 words correct per minute. For example, this is Faizan. So there are such goals in everything, in maths, in reading comprehension, in grammar, in fluency, and we hold ourselves strictly accountable to producing this change in the classroom. Now, we found that we have a goal for our pupils, but the most important person that we have to invest, apart from the student in our work, is the parent of the student. So we started having parent-teacher meetings with our students, and it was a very fascinating journey knowing the parents of our students, because most of the parents of our students are daily wage earners. Often they have themselves had only, say, third or fourth grade of schooling. So though they have a dream that I want to make my son or daughter a doctor or an engineer, they don't really know how to connect the dots between what the child is doing right now, which is, say, learning subtraction in third grade, and how that helps the child to become an engineer after 12 years. Or for example, if a child who is born in 2000, who is now 11 years old, will have to write a grade 10 exam in 2016, a grade 12 exam after that, and an undergraduation. So we found that our work with the parents was a lot of this, you know, connecting the dots between the larger goals that the parents have for their students and for what we do with them. We found that so far, the children have only had a system of rote learning and memorization, and surprisingly, the parents don't seem to complain. So we started to find out why this is the case. What we found is that every day, like in the example of Pratap that I showed you, the pupils go back home with about 12 pages of written material in English, which they are just blindly copying down from a textbook. Now the parents of the children themselves cannot read English. So they are thinking that my child is making a lot of progress, but what is actually happening is that the child is going perilously close to dropping out. So after we found buy-in with the parents, like when the parents saw the work that we were doing, they were very happy. Initially they were a little confused because what they were used to was a lot of written work coming in, but then we explained to them our ideas of understanding concepts. Like for example, if you're teaching subtraction, the idea of subtraction is that if you give a 100 rupee note in a shop and the thing that you're buying is costing 40 rupees, you are supposed to get 60 rupees back. So rather than having a subtraction where I have to do problem number 1 to problem number 8, this becomes an immediate and relevant concept in the life of the pupil. So we started going into the communities of our pupils, and this was a huge shock. Now I was teaching in the suburb of Bandra in Mumbai, which is comparatively an affluent suburb in our country, but nothing really prepared me for what I saw. So there's one pupil in my child who actually saw an aunt of his getting killed in a cylinder burst in the house. There are pupils who get electrocuted in the rainy season because there are live wires running through the community. Near the community, there are cars which whiz past at very high speed, and every year there are fatalities of children which happen over there. There is one girl in my class who spends the entire monsoon sitting and sleeping on a bed with 8 other people on one bed because the entire house gets flooded. So they put stones under the bed, they raise the bed above the flood line, and they sit like that. And they sleep like that. So if you think of this situation that our pupils are coming from, for me it's a miracle that they ever, you know, get out of the house and even come to school. That itself is a big victory. So going into the community, meeting the parents realize that these people are not doing mere symbolism or tokenism. They are really here to stay for 2 years and to positively impact our children. The next step that I found was important was providing role models for our pupils. Now what happens is, in the community that the pupils are, there is a lot of culture of violence and intimidation. So for the boys, the gunda or the dada element becomes automatically a role model. So we feel that that needs to change. So we started introducing people we knew, we started calling them, inviting them to the classroom. So we got Viren Raskina, who is the India hockey captain, and he taught the students how to hit penalty corners, and then he also talked to them about teamwork and about integrity. This is Manan, another friend of mine who makes model aeroplanes. I know there are many of you here who do the same, and he actually showed the children how to fly a model aeroplane. This is Captain Sonal Gopuskar, a friend of mine. She explained how an aircraft which is so heavy can actually fly in the sky. This is Danesh Bharucha, a historian from France, who told them the story of Napoleon, and the children immediately said, oh, so then Napoleon was a French Shivaji. So they made the connection between what they were learning here and the story of Napoleon. And Manasvi Mamgai, Miss India, she also talked about how she was when she was an 8-year-old or 9-year-old child, her vulnerabilities, her struggle in life. So after introducing role models to the pupils, the next thing we felt is that we want the children to go out of their enclosed communities and to really see what is there around. So we started taking them on field visits. So one of the field visits was to bookstores, and it's so amazing when you take like 8 or 9 year old children from a municipal school for the first time to a bookstore, and there are all these hundreds of new, crisp, amazing smelling books there. The children were like, what do I read and what do I not? And that builds an incentive for the children to actually start reading. We took them to ADAPT, which is an NGO called Able Disabled All People Together in Bandra Reclamation. So far our pupils were feeling sorry for themselves because of the economic conditions. But at ADAPT they met children with serious physical challenges, you know, who may have come from privileged backgrounds but who were living such difficult lives. And then they didn't feel so unfortunate themselves. And they realized that they can also be useful and serve other people in society. Another thing that our pupils did is that they made cheese sandwiches, and we took them to a home for the elderly in Bandra. And the children actually performed a dance for them and interacted with the inmates there. In Bandra, we have a large coastline where there are a lot of mangroves which are really dirty, and the children live in communities which are very close to that. So we all went out to the mangroves of Bandra, and the children actually put on gloves and cleaned the mangroves. And the children took part with this project in the Design for Change contest, and they actually won a top 100 prize. And we also once went to an IPL match. So, first we talked about setting a goal for the students and also investing their parents and their communities in what they do. Now one of the biggest problems that we have in education is the problem of rote learning. So how do we make learning interesting and fun for pupils so that it becomes relevant to their daily lives? So this is an example of a comprehension of a food packet. So you can see a packet of milk over there, and it's amazing how many things you can learn just from that packaging. So in math you can learn percentage, because the percentage of the fats, proteins, carbohydrates, etc. You can learn shapes, because this is a cuboid, you can have a cylinder, you can have different shapes. You can learn history. If you have a packet of wheat flakes, how did a grain of wheat become a wheat flake? You can learn geography. There is a manufacturer's address over there which they can find, you know. So there are different things that we can do. So I just wanted to run a video for you about a comprehension that the students did on food packaging.
Wheat flakes.
And what are the ingredients?
Another comprehension we did was with postcards. So you bring a number of different postcards to the class, and the pupils actually let their imagination run riot about, you know, what if they as a group went out together to a place that is shown on the postcard, and you know what they do there, and what are the other things that would be possible there. So this is an example of a comprehension, a video about comprehension on postcards.
Okay, this place is called
Cambodia.
What do you see here?
I see a temple.
I see many.
Another interesting thing that you can actually do is activity-based learning. So instead of just taking a textbook and teaching a lesson, we actually just went out into the garden of the school, and this was a lesson called Improved Methods of Agriculture. So the children actually simulated everything from tilling the ground, sowing the seeds, preparing fertilizer, etc. The next interesting idea that we implemented in our school was video assessments. So normally comprehension is something which is you just take a piece, a passage, and then you answer questions on that. But what we did was we actually showed a simple English film with subtitles in it, and we asked the pupils questions on that, and they actually answered these questions themselves. And then we would sit with the pupil together and we would look at that video, and they would say how better they could have answered to build their speaking and listening skills.
From the story of Sakina, that we would not have to destroy anyone's house, and we have to take care of their house because they are our neighbor and they are our friends.
So 2 years went by, and you know, at the end of the 2 years, this is a story that a student called Ashutosh has written. This boy could not write A to Z when he started in the third standard, and he's actually written a story about a man, a dog, and a lion. And you know, that moment is so amazing when this child, you know, who 2 years ago could not write alphabets, is now writing full sentences, you know, and the joy and the pride that shine in the eyes of the parent are unbelievable. This is another pupil, Poonam, who, you know, today can take part in a debate on a topic like we had a debate on what is important, love or money. And she was a pupil who could not actually make a sentence in English, was able to debate this topic. There are other things that one can do if one enters the school system on a sustainable basis. For example, we went out on Facebook and we said that we want to establish a library and a sports center in our school. Please give us money. So people gave us books, people donated money for the steel cupboards. We were able to buy a lot of equipment. And slowly, as the 2 years went on, we found that in 2 years, the pupils were able to make 3.8 years of growth. Now what happens if you remember that achievement gap slide that I showed you before? If you increase the growth by just 1 year in a single year, then the gap remains the same. So for the gap to reduce, the learning of the pupils has to increase by more than 1 year. So that's the sort of work that we want to do, and that's the sort of outstanding young person that we want to go into our underprivileged schools and teach to effectuate this kind of transformational learning. So for me, it was amazing, because what I found was that in a school like mine, everything that I needed to be a great leader, which is to communicate with the students, to have organization skills for myself, to persevere, to have willingness to learn, all these qualities were those that make a great leader. So the qualities that you need to be a great teacher are not different from the qualities that you need to be a great leader. So my request to you is, find a low-income school, a private or a government school, which is near your house or near where you study. Go there. Volunteer, just ask to spend some time with the pupils, help them out with reading, something as simple as reading. Share your story, tell them who you are. It's amazing for these children to have like a didi or a bhaiya whom they can look up to, and you know, whom they can think of emulating. So I just wanted to end with the question of legacy. So all of us want to leave a legacy in the world, and one way that we can leave a legacy in the world is by building a big monument for ourselves. Okay, and this monument is a metaphor. It can mean a large amount of money in the bank, you know, it can mean success in terms of a high designation in a company, or we can leave a living legacy in terms of the excellent education that we provide to the underprivileged children in our country. So it's legacy or it's legacy. The choice is ours. Thank you very much.